Is this the dumbest way of solving a maze? We're starting at this orange point here, and we gotta find, like, how do we get to the exit? And my idea is that I'm gonna let a gas go here, and then, you know, at some point, one of the atoms of the gas is gonna reach the exit.
Just by sheer luck?
By luck, yeah. It's gonna be basically moving randomly. If I do more and more molecules, then I expect that one would get there faster. I've released a poisonous gas here, and then eventually, like, a canary dies over here or something. And here they go. So quite quickly they've spread out and they're going, and we've got a few going around here. After a while, this is the one that's going to end up winning. It got out there first, and this is the path that it took the whole time. Spends a bunch of wasted time in here, but here you go. You've got a solution. It does some silly things like going up here when it didn't need to, but you know, this is basically how to solve this maze.
I love it, Matt.
Yeah?
I love the thought of there was that one molecule there that was destined for greatness, and it didn't even know it would be the one.
Right,
do
yeah.
Do you know what it reminds me of?
What?
Sperm going to the egg.
Like, yeah.
Like which
yeah.
sperm will yeah. become a human.
It's totally like that, yeah. And it's just pure luck, right? I think there's various metaphors that you can draw here, like, you know, everybody is just bumping around randomly, but the one person that, you know, became a billionaire or something, they wrote their autobiography, how I got here, all the great decisions I made to beat everybody. Hey, it was just random. It's a bit of a sort of inside joke in that in computer science, there's all these different algorithms for doing things efficiently. And, you know, solving mazes is a big example of like where you might apply these algorithms.
Like the lightning algorithm we did in a previous video.
Right, exactly. And that was, you know, finding the shortest path. Like you find it efficiently and what you get is the shortest path from the cloud that seeds the lightning all the way down to the ground. But here, well, one thing I've done is I've said the maze is actually going to be this physical thing. I've forgotten about the concept of like cells of the maze and their adjacency, like where you can get to from each. And I've just said, well, there's a little tiny molecule in there somewhere and it's moving around. It doesn't even know when it's left one cell and it's gone into the other. It's sort of a joke about there might be like the most efficient way to do something, but hey, this works. And maybe it's not the dumbest way because it does work. Right. You could either create a computer, like write all the code to solve this program, encode it in the transistors of the computer, or I'm saying, you know, just release like a bad smell. You could maybe take this solution that we found and improve it. Imagine that this orange squiggly path is actually a piece of string and just pull it tight. And then it would be a much better solution to the maze.
Another, it would also be interesting yeah. to see if you pulled that tight, how long it is.
Yeah, like, yeah, like, yeah.
How much longer a path did it take than it had to?
Yeah, one thing about this maze is that it doesn't have any kind of loops around it, and that's kind of by design. And that means that works particularly well for the string pulling tight thing, because you're not going to get a knot anywhere, and you're just going to you will get the shortest path if you pull it tight. Another thing you could do is model the interactions between molecules. Each one is its individual little thing. It doesn't know about all the other molecules and it's just moving around. In real life, you might have some bouncing of those, and that's, I guess, is like pressure. And that would help it expand out from the beginning and give you an even better solution. But obviously that's harder to program because you gotta, am I bumping into this one? Am I bumping into that one? That would be inefficient. And then another thing you could do is like, do some kind of fluid dynamics maybe. So if you had like some wind, just blow a hairdryer in here, it might help guide the molecules out, and the air from the hairdryer has to escape out here eventually because of pressure. That might give you a faster solution. And the first step is figuring out how to create a nice maze. And I wanted that property where there's a path between every single point in the maze. And there's not going to be any loops. We're going to have a network of points on a grid. Eventually, I want to figure out what are the walls, but I'm actually first going to think about what are the paths that create the maze. What I want is to say that there's a path between all points, and I'm just going to just start and create random ones. So like if I start drawing in things here, what I'm doing is I'm adding edges, not randomly. I'll add an edge if it's not going to create a loop anywhere. And I also want to make sure that I reach every single point. You know, maybe I go here and I have go down here and then here. These are paths and they're the walls. I could create walls that make these valid paths, but they're going to be on a grid that's sort of offset from this one. So for example, I better have a wall here. Otherwise I should have had a line that connected those two. I need a wall here. So I'm just blocking the stuff off that needs to be blocked. But you can't go from here to here without going around here. So there should be a wall there as well. Likewise, there should be a wall here. And now I'm just gonna enclose the whole thing. And then I'm gonna add a little like goal at the end. Maybe you start here. And so the maze is actually kind of an artifact of me having found this network of where you can go to from each point, which is called a tree. Tree is just a network where there's no loops in it. It means that you end up having a nice maze, because if you have too many edges, then you don't have very many walls. In the code is I pick a width and a height, and I create this fully connected graph here. So that is, I'm just saying like, what is the grid graph? That means a graph where everything's connected to the thing to the left, above, to the right, and down, but just for some fixed rectangular size. And then I assigned random number to each of those edges. And then I asked Mathematica to find the tree that spans all of those points, meaning it visits all of the vertices there, that has the smallest total weight on all the edges. That's just a way for it to come with a random maze each time. So for example, this was a potential edge I could have picked, but maybe it had a weight of 100. That means it had a cost basically of 100, whereas this one had one. So that's why I picked, you know, these ones, not that one. So if we do that, can you see we get this network of all the paths that you can take from each point? I then have a nice guarantee that I can put a goal here and a start point there, and I know there's gonna be a solution, because you can get to anywhere in the maze from anywhere else. So now I've just got to figure out the step I did here when I went from the green pen to the brown pen. What are the walls that make that? Not too much more code, and you get this picture here. So side by side, here we've got the network and we've got the walls that should create that network. You can kind of see it looks right. So for example, here we've got a path from this point. You can't get directly there. You've got to go up and around and down, which is correct, up and right and down. Yeah, so that's how we've created the walls. Now all we gotta do is simulate molecules inside this environment.
Is that hard or easy?
It's just, yeah, it is hard or easy. There's a few tricks you gotta do to make it not just take forever. On the other hand, like, I just gotta make one animation and post it on my Twitter, so I don't really care if it takes too long. So it's a bit of one of those things where I could optimize it and make it very fast, or I could, you know, solve the maze in the dumbest way. So I switched over to Python to start simulating the molecules. Here's a code that does that. Imagine at each point, I'm trying to figure out, I've got a molecule here. I'm just going to add a totally random direction. So each time it's going to like take a tiny step in a new direction. And I need to make sure that I'm not going to cross a wall. I end up here. And then if I go over here, hey, that's a problem. I'm now intersecting with a wall, so I've got to go back.
These aren't like your famous bouncing balls that only change direction when they hit a wall. They can change direction whenever they want.
They're moving every time step. And that is what's called Brownian motion, or just a random walk. You know, molecules dancing around. And then in real life, that might be because they're actually bouncing into smaller molecules. Like, these might be some heavier gas in just the air. Bumping into the small molecules of the air is just making it look like, hey, they're jittering around all the time.
Okay.
But so I've got jittering around randomly all the time, but also I've got to make sure, don't go into a wall. If it looks like you're going to go into a wall, just reverse your direction and you won't hit the wall. So I program it so that each point I know what are the nearby walls around there. And then I do some math to say, hey, am I actually intersecting? So this block of code here, I'm saying I've got a point P, and I've got some sort of structure that tells me what are the walls that I've got going on. And I'm saying, am I going to clip into the walls or not? Now, I run the code and it will just keep on simulating again and again and again. I do them in big batches, and then the first batch that has a winner in it, I just stop computation. So I'll show you what that looks like.
But surely every batch will eventually have a winner.
Right, but I do each batch for a maximum length of time and then move on to the next batch. So I've kind of guessed. I've said, you know, 10,000 steps or whatever is probably going to be enough. Or I've kind of set a goal and I'm just going to simulate enough until I get to a solution.
Because presumably if you do an infinite number of batches, eventually you'll get one particle that just by luck just perfectly
just goes the exact way. Yeah, totally. I could, for example, reject some of those solutions and say, ah, it's not good enough, and keep going. I leave my computer running overnight. If I just run this, hopefully it still works. I'm simulating a batch of, I think, 64 points for 45,000 time steps. And I've got a progress bar saying this is how long it's going to take. We're doing some screen recording to capture that, so this is much slower than it usually is. But yeah, I mean, I would just run this, leave it. Computer beeps when it's found something, and then I would bring it back into Mathematica and do the animation. Let's look at how we do the, like, draw everything and draw the backtrace and stuff. Once we find a solution, my code there just outputs, like, here's all the paths. And I know that one of them won in the end. So first of all, I've got to figure out what is the molecule that won. And also I've got to just draw them all going around and everything like that. I'm loading in solutions that were found. We ended up running 1,856 molecules will be in the animation. One of them got to the end. What I did was I set it up so that this is the y equals zero line. So I find a solution, just one that reaches a negative y value. That's kind of an easy test for me. And then this code here is doing the animation. Each molecule obviously just gets drawn as a little point here. And then we've done that check to see, well, which is the one that reaches a negative y value? And then that's the one that we've realized is the winner, and we trace it back to the beginning. Some people are like, well, how did you know that one was going to win? Like, how did you know to, like, put a circle around it? Well, actually, I just kept running this program and I logged everything. When I'm creating these frames, I'm not running the simulation. I'm just displaying the simulation. The simulation, as you say, is a file that has logged all the movements.
So you could open up, like, you know, a spreadsheet or a log that would show the winning molecules path.
That's right. I basically stored a spreadsheet where I've got 1,856 different molecules. And then for each one of them, I've got 4,500 XY coordinates. Just massive loads and loads of numbers.
And you know what my next question is, don't you? I want to see its log. I want to see the log of the winning ball. Yeah. Is that even possible to find?
The log of the winning ball?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's possible to find.
Does he have a name or a number, that winning ball?
Yeah, he's got an index, so it's 1,836. So if I look at the 1,836th thing here, here are all the points. So the starting point was 1,9, and then at the end, it's got a negative y value.
That's his path.
So it won.
That doesn't look very complicated for how wiggly his path was.
I've cut out 4,489 other points.
Right.
And you can see that because here's his path.
Yeah, he got a bit stuck there for a while, didn't he?
Totally stuck there. Pick another number. We could compare how it did.
How did ball one do?
Yeah, good idea. Red is the winner and blue is the first one.
So ball one got stuck up there and just hung around there for ages.
Yeah, that's right. Ball two did that. Ball three did this. And, you know, so I kept simulating. Eventually I got to ball 1,836 in the last batch. Here's 1,835, did that. Each one is just totally random. So if I change this slider, look, here's all the different paths that we find.
Let's see if we can find a really funny one where he got stuck badly.
That's not a great one. Looks like it came down. Oh, it was doing pretty straight line stuff, but then hung around in that area. That one didn't get very far. The scale is changing because it's fitting,
right. But
it's obviously just in the first 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9-ish.
Yeah. That's fascinating.
And the winner. The winner looks, I mean, it's still doing something pretty dumb.
Look at these people in the gym, endlessly preening, posing, and hopefully improving their bodies. Go on, big man. But do they ever give their brain a workout? If so, their mental gymnasiums should be this. Brilliant. These courses, quizzes, and collections of problems are barbells for your brain. They're interactive, carefully designed, and unlike a normal gym, they're lots of fun. So don't just sit there and let your brain turn to mush. Give it a workout with Brilliant. There's new content being added all the time, and you can get 20% off a premium subscription by going to brilliant.org/numberphile. You can also give Brilliant as a gift to other people. They're great people at Brilliant, and we also appreciate that they love supporting us here at Numberphile, so thank you very much.